Hello, and welcome to Flunking the Written, a Buffy the Vampire Slayer podcast in which two uber fans discuss their favorite show, episode by episode, scene by scene. I'm Kimberly.
And I'm Megan. And before we get started, we want all of our listeners to know that this is a fully spoiled podcast. That means at any point during our discussion, we may bring up any part of Buffy the Vampire Slayer and its spinoff, Angel.
So if you haven't watched both shows and are sensitive to spoilers, go catch up on some of the greatest television ever created and come back here when you're done.
With that out of the way, let's jump right into this week's episode of Flunking the Written. Okay, so we are about to begin our scene-by-scene breakdown of Out of Mind, Out of Sight. This episode is another kind of odd one. This is another story by Joss Whedon, but the teleplay is by Ashley Gable and Thomas A. Swiden, and it is directed by Reza Bedi. I actually looked up how to pronounce his name, and I found like 8 different ways to pronounce it, so I'm going to go with that one. But the blurb is, as Cordelia prepares for Sunnydale High's May Queen competition, an invisible force starts attacking her closest friends. Which, we'll get into this, in the episode. I think they're still technically her closest friends, but the episode actually kind of addresses the fact that none of Cordelia's friends are really close with her.
Yeah, lots and lots of Cordelia in this episode.
Yes, this is our first major Cordelia episode. And I don't know about you, Kim, but I remember this episode being better than I thought it was on this particular viewing.
I did too.
This episode's not great.
Yeah, I remember thinking that too.
It is.
And I have so many questions about the ending. Just so many questions. Like pages and pages.
Yeah. It's got some good ideas, but the execution and like the weird additions that they tried to like blend into the Buffyverse that really weren't meshable things. They threw me off for sure.
Well, it starts with Cordelia and Harmony and Mitch, who is described in the script book as a hunk du jour.
I did not get that from the viewing this time around. I did not look at that man and was just like, oh, yes, hunk du jour. But
it is described as in the script book. And they're discussing the end of school dance and walking through the halls of Sunnydale High. And they're discussing Cordelia being elected May Queen of the dance, which everyone is 100% sure is going to happen.
Mm-hmm. Including the audience.
Yes, including the audience. As they walk by the library, Buffy runs out and bumps into them and drops a bag full of weapons. Which is kind of odd because none of these are weapons that she would, like, there's a mace.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, I've never seen Buffy use that before.
It's like a little overkill considering that there doesn't seem to be anything specific going on. My only guess is that Giles, like, heard that there's some kind of inspection going on at the library and he had to, like, smuggle the weapons out and Buffy just shoved the bunch in her bag.
I guess that would be the only thing for me because, like, I'm not sure if she ever fights with a mace, but definitely not in season one.
Yeah. I think her excuse, though, as much as she tries, is really funny because we have seen multiple times in this season that Buffy has history class with Cordelia. So the fact that she's like, oh, this is for show and tell in history class, you know, Cordelia is not buying and that.
And she just babbles and babbles. And then, you know, they're rude to her, like they are.
Yeah.
And there is a comment here as Buffy leaves and they start to walk off, where Cordelia starts to tell the story. It was cut out of the episode, but there's a comment here where Cordelia starts to tell Mitch the story about, did I ever tell you about when Buffy attacked me at the Bronze? And it's like exaggerated that Buffy attacked her with a spear.
A spear,
and she,
okay.
A spear, and that she almost died and stuff. And I'm like, that story escalated a little bit.
So here's what I will say, and I think both Cordy and Buffy are guilty of it in this episode, but Cordy's the first one to have the offense. And the show, Buffy the Vampire Slayer, has a real back problem, and we'll get into this a lot in season 5 when it deals with, like, severe mental disorders. But, like, Cordy, like, calls Buffy a mental or something like that in this very first scene. But later on, when we're dealing with Marcy, there's a lot of stuff with Marcy that's clearly led Marcy to become unhinged to a degree. And there's a lot of dialogue choices in this episode that really bothered me. And that's just something that as a viewer of this show, you kind of have to take the bad with the good. There's a lot of good in this show, but the way that it handles really harder mental, like, I think the season 6, the way it handles depression is really good, but schizophrenia or like those really hard mental disorders, it's just, it doesn't handle it with any grace whatsoever, and this is kind of our first little taste of that.
Well, in this scene, you know, the boyfriend tells her, let me guess, blue like your eyes, and she replies, my eyes are hazel, Helen Keller.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be the first one. But I see that.
There's a lot of that in season 5, which I hate because it's like my favorite season, but like in season 5, I'm just like, oh, stop, please stop. So we'll get into that a lot more later on. Then we go to class, and they are discussing Shylock and his anger of being an outcast, and Cordy has this lovely dialogue of how self-involved he is.
And shows how self-involved she is.
Shylock should get over himself. People who think their problems are so huge craze me. Like this time I sort of ran over this girl on her bike. It was the most traumatizing event of my life, and she's trying to make it about her leg. Like my pain meant nothing.
I'm concerned about this teacher who calls it an interesting point.
Well, it's funny because, like, when she's doing the discussion, like, with the whole class, she's saying it almost as if she's just like, all right, Cordelia, yeah, we all know your way of thinking. We'll just move past it. That's all very good. You voiced your thing. But then afterwards...
See, I didn't catch that.
Afterwards, when she's talking one-on-one, she does seem very, like, supportive. Like, yeah, good insights. Good job, Cordy. But, like, in class, it just felt like almost like enough of a, all right, I'll just humor you so we can get past this and into the real, like, dialogue.
Well, see, I didn't catch that. I actually was watching it. When I was watching it, it seemed like the teacher was taking her seriously. And I'm like, why are you, like, letting this go on, you know? But she might have been just kind of trying to move the conversation on.
Yeah. Well, I think, honestly, this isn't a very good, like, display of that, because apparently Miss Miller has like very active students that always raise their hands. I'll talk about that later in this episode, but
yeah, I saw that.
But I just think, like, no matter how weird the like thought process is, any high school teacher would just be thrilled that a student was just like, hey, I have an opinion on this, I'm gonna show.
Yeah. I thought it was really, really interesting how you could see how annoyed Willow is in this episode, because Cordelia's not letting her talk. And then when they're leaving the classroom and the teacher is complimenting Cordelia on what she said, and she makes the comment, it's nice to know that a student actually did the reading, you can see Willow, like, right behind her, roll her eyes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Cordelia basically talks a little bit about needing some help with her writing process and wants to meet with Miss Miller, which I actually kind of like, because we learn a little bit about Cordelia throughout this run that she's not as ditzy or as airheaded as one might assume.
She is
a little bit of an academic. They arrange that, and then she walks out and meets Harmony, and of course foreshadows Mitch is gonna die, which I believe doesn't come until the next episode, but Mitch is actually one of the victims in Prophecy Girl.
Oops.
Oopsie. But then we cut to the locker room, which always leads to good.
There's a thing to notice in between these two scenes when Cordelia and Harmony are walking in the hallway. The camera kind of changed the point of view. Mm-hmm. So it looks like somebody else is watching them.
Yeah, there's a lot of that.
Even though there's nobody there. There is a lot of that. And I'm not going to mention it every time, but this is the first
first occurrence. I actually didn't notice it in this scene. I noticed it several times throughout the episode. I didn't notice it in this particular scene.
Yeah, where it just kind of, the camera kind of like suddenly changes. Mm-hmm. And it's like someone's looking from a different direction, but no one's there. And they don't see anybody. And it happens a lot. And we figure out later who it is. But that's the first time I noticed it. But yeah, the next scene is the locker room where we have Mitch, our hunk, and a couple of his buddies. And they're, doing gross
high school locker room talk. Just being awful. Now, here's what I'll say. And I watched this scene a couple of times because I don't know if this was intentional or just kind of a weird, like, oh, okay, we got to get these two guys out of this scene so Marcy can come in and beat this guy with a bat. But, like, Mitch says the gross line of, wanting to be on more than just Cordelia's arm. And, like, the two guys just, like, okay, and then walk out. They're just like, yeah, all right. And then they just immediately leave. They don't respond. They don't even really react to that. They just immediately leave. And there's even just, like, a little bit of a face drop on Mitch. And I'm just like, I don't really think it was intentional in any way, but...
Probably not, because I don't know if a show in 1996, 97 would have... made that point.
But I just like the optimist in me is just like those two guys like immediately left the room and just like, that guy's a jerk.
We can hope. But then Mitch starts, finishing getting dressed and he hears a giggle. And I'm gonna point out in this scene it takes Mitch a really long time to buckle his belt.
It's a complicated task.
working on buckling his belt for a long time. And hears the giggle, and he does the classic, who's there? And starts to go back to buckling his belt. Hears it again and says, okay, fun time's over, come out. And he reaches for a baseball bat, which I guess, he was going to use it as a weapon. And it floats up in the air on its own and starts beating him.
Something about season one, they just love their baseball bats. It's a really easy prop, I guess. But I mean, after Willow charging around with a baseball bat. You have the whole storyline in Nightmares where the kid got beaten with a baseball bat. Now we got another baseball bat in this episode. It's just like, if we could just get rid of all baseball bats in Sunnydale, I think that would be an improvement.
Yeah, possibly. And then next we have Buffy at her locker as Cordelia walks around handing out chocolates, kind of her campaign for May Queen. And she gets to Buffy and is very catty with Buffy.
Yeah. Again, again, has some choice words. I'm just like,
And I'm like, wouldn't you just want every vote you could get? Like, why would you ostracize people who could vote for you on purpose?
Yeah. I feel like the Buffy hate that Cordy holds, it was really cranked up in this episode. And I mean, there's reasons, I suppose. I mean, Buffy did attack her with a stick that one time.
A spear.
She almost died. But like, I feel like it was really cranked up in this episode. The Buffy Cordy relationship, I don't think really ever made it to
where
it could have been. Like the idea of Cordy being like Buffy's alternate life, what path Buffy would have gone down had she not been chosen.
The Slayer.
Like, I feel like there would have been more opportunities to have those two characters relate, and there's an odd episode here or there, but they really don't have the amount of screen time that I really think that they should have, considering how similar they really are. But yeah, then Xander and Willow come up and ask what Cordy's doing, and then are very quickly reminded of a story about Cordelia, which is completely unintelligible.
Oh, God. Remember in sixth grade with the field trip?
Right, the guy with the antlers on his belt.
Be my deputy.
And remember the hat? Oh, God,
the hat.
Gee, it's fun that we're speaking in tongues.
I love this so much. I love Xander and Willow in this episode, and they're couple of moments of interaction with each other to show just how long these two have been friends and the the relationship that has developed there. And this is one of those.
Yeah, the connection.
Yeah, this is one of those moments that even though it's clearly like set up to be like kind of another outcast moment for Buffy, and you feel that because it's very much a Buffy.
See it, yeah.
Buffy feels like an outcast throughout all of this episode. An outcast from the life she used to have, and an outcast even in the life that she's in currently, because she doesn't process what's going on here with Xander and Willow. But I also just look at the relationship between Xander and Willow in this moment. I'm just like, oh, they're so adorable.
And there's another moment like that later on when they're leaving to go to dinner. But in this scene right here, every single time I watch this episode, I want to know the story. It drives me crazy to get to this the story. Because what we know is that it has to do with Cordelia trying too hard, a man that has antlers on his belt, and someone says, be my deputy.
Mm-hmm.
And like, that is just not enough information. Then someone runs up saying, someone wailed on Mitch, guys. Come on. I think he's... And then it cuts out and we open to Principal Snyder continuing the comment. But what he says is just hilarious. I love it. He's like, dead? Of course not. Dead? What are you, ghouls? There are no dead students here this week. I love it. I love it. Our trio immediately walks up and starts talking to Mitch. And no one stops them. Leaves the EMTs. No one stops this conversation.
They actually pause to allow Buffy to talk to him.
Yeah.
They're just like, oh, we got to get this student to a hospital. Oh, wait. This other student wants to talk for a minute. Okay, it's fine.
Yeah. And so Mitch explains that the bat attacked him by itself. And they take him away. And Buffy immediately says, I got to check the scene. And starts walking in front of all these people. Including Principal Snyder. And I'm like, you know, try to be a little covert. But
yeah, go get a trench coat and some glasses. Come on. Yeah. What are you doing?
They have to distract him and stuff. Yeah. Although Snyder does make a comment here that he notices that Buffy is always sticking her nose in. Yeah, a little preview of that relationship. She goes and finds the lockers, and there they are, have spray painted the word look on them.
Mm-hmm. Again, we gotta just accept the fact that the police in Sunnydale just don't exist.
Because they left the bat there?
Well, yeah, the bat's there. There's nothing really there to show that there's been any kind of investigation on what's happened. I mean, I don't even know if the police showed up. So, yeah, the Sunnydale Police Department is deeply stupid, as Snyder will eventually say.
Very deeply stupid. Or don't care.
Just don't.
One or the other.
You know, to be fair, though, if you want to talk about mortality rate, we've talked about Sunnydale High principals. We've talked about managers at the Bronze. I imagine the police department has a really hard time holding on to people.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Definitely. And then we have Buffy and Xander and Willow in the cafeteria talking about it, and Giles joins them. And they have a little discussion about what the baddie is that did this to Mitch. Although there's a little conversation between them that's cut out that is Giles and Buffy discussing whether or not it's safe to talk in the cafeteria.
Okay.
And, you know, we don't see a whole lot of that.
Mm-hmm.
They generally just talk wherever they are about anything and never worry about people overhearing. But that was there where they had a little discussion about, is it safe to talk here and stuff like that. And it just got cut out for time, yeah. I guess.
Well, I noticed there was a little bit of awkward acting, and I wasn't just sure if it was just like, oh, I'm a teacher sitting down with students at lunch. This is weird. perhaps that would be viewed as like, yeah, that's not how that normally works.
There's one other line I'm going to mention in the scene where they're discussing what the bad guy is, and they kind of land on this idea that it's a ghost.
Mm-hmm.
And are discussing who all it could be and talking about getting a list of missing or not missing a list of dead kids. And Xander mentions how it's going to be a long list. And Willow replies, have you seen the in memory section of the yearbook? And that was cut out. But I was just thinking to myself, wow, do you imagine having a yearbook with a in memory section that many people are lost every year that you have to have that? And I'm, you know, it. That happens in real life for like a tragedy, like a school shooting or a car accident with a bunch of students in it or something. But it's not something you have in there every year. And I'm just like, why do people still live in Sunnydale? Like, why do they not move away? Because we've discussed a whole bunch how, like, people don't remember.
Uh-huh.
They notice that there's an in-memory section every year. I'm just saying. It was cut out, so
yeah,
it doesn't really matter. It just made me think a lot.
Well, it's making me think a lot, too, because I'm flashing forward to the Wish and just thinking, how did Sunnydale go downhill that fast just because of the absence of Buffy? When Buffy wasn't there for, you know, all of this past awfulness that led to the events of this first season, to where that's a regular thing in the Sunnydale High yearbook in this scenario, enough to where, you know, students are making casual remarks on it. Like, how wasn't it already as bleak as it is in The Wish?
The Master. He was still underground. He came above ground.
But I don't think that's going to be I don't think that's enough. The only turning point. Like, I feel like the happy-go-lucky environment of the sunny California, you know, just, you know, bright and shiny and bubbly atmosphere that we see in a lot of, like, the lighter scenes in Buffy. I'm just like, no, that's not Sunnydale. Sunnydale wouldn't be like that. There would be curfews like crazy. No one would. The Bronze wouldn't be a thing. Like,
oh, definitely not. They do this, and then they have that conversation and decide like what they're going to research and stuff. And then we cut to the next scene where it's Harmony and Cordelia discussing Mitch and Cordelia having gone to see him in the hospital. And then it cuts to kind of like a black and white type scene. Harmony and Cordelia are talking. And someone walks up to them, like, their point of view, and Cordelia says very cattily, what do you want?
Mm-hmm.
And so, right now, we're like, oh, it is a ghost. You know, it's someone remembering this. Then that cuts out, and it's Cordelia and Harmony again talking.
I don't know. I like the flashback sequences well enough, but I'm not entirely sure if they're necessary. I guess it's trying to, like, make you sympathize with Marcy a little bit as this progresses, but she's not really a sympathetic character.
Well, she might have been when it first happened. She's not now.
Yeah.
But she might have been more sympathetic when it first happened to her, you know?
I think the episode could have gone into a direction that would have made her a very sympathetic character, but it chose not to, and I think that was a very deliberate decision, which kind of weakens the episode for me, personally. But we'll get into that.
But they only have an hour.
Yeah.
Cordelia and Harmony are walking, and they're at that big staircase, and Buffy stops Cordelia and asks her to talk, and Harmony gets pushed down the stairs, and, like, you see her get pushed down the stairs, except nobody's there, which is freaky. While they're at the bottom of the stairs checking to see how she is, Buffy hears another giggle and a voice say she deserved it, even though no one's talking.
I didn't actually notice that she deserved it. I noticed the, like,
okay.
Buffy, like, kind of, like, reacting to something, and I knew that there was, like, a giggle, but I didn't hear that actual bit of dialogue. So now
I
want to
go
listen for it.
I didn't either.
It may not have made it in.
I didn't hear. Well, see, and that's what I thought. In fact, in my notes, I have at that point that my little symbol beside it that I used to mean that it was cut out of the actual episode, except later on, Buffy tells Willow and Xander that she heard the girl say something, but I didn't hear it either. I just heard the giggle.
Well, now I feel like I have to do some investigating.
Yeah.
Which is what Buffy goes to do. Buffy goes to investigate.
Exactly. But I didn't hear it either. So you are not alone. And when I heard Buffy tell them that, I was like, okay, I guess I just missed it. Or it's possible that part was cut out and the other line was a mistake and didn't get cut out.
Yeah. But yeah, Buffy goes, into the like band room, music room, and you see a ceiling tile lower back into place. Does she actually, when does she like physically like run into her? Like, is it in this moment? Like, there's a moment where she like bumps into her.
Yes, it is.
Okay, so Buffy is like super, super calm through all of this.
Like, being bumped into by nothing.
And she's just like, hey, I'm not going to hurt you. I just want to, like, hang out. I mean, I'm just like, woof.
yeah.
But it was interesting because... And Buffy loses her patience at the end of this episode, too. But I just watched Lessons, which is the first episode of season 7. And there's kind of a weird, like, ghost, not ghost thing that she faces in Lessons as well. Which Marcy's definitely not a ghost, but they kind of have that thought
they
that she's
a
ghost
at
first. So I kind of started drawing comparisons. But Buffy has, like, no chill in Lessons. She's like, I don't care about you. I don't care how you died. I'm just here to save my sister. You guys can just stop with whatever spook tactics you're trying. Which I thought was an interesting, like,
she's had like 7 years of dealing with this.
Yeah. It's
and she
interesting
just doesn't care anymore.
See. Yeah, it's interesting to see like later Buffy versus early Buffy. So I noticed that it's just like, ah, Buffy's like super patient and like calm and like trying to reason with this. And in season 7, she's like, nope, you just are a inconvenience in my life that I got to get through so I can move on.
And the next scene is Buffy and Giles and Xander and Willow again. And they're discussing, and there is like 2 whole pages of dialogue that's cut out here. And none of it really matters or is that important or clever or anything, except that Giles mentions that Harmony has a compound fracture of her leg, which I feel would have been a lot more painful than what Harmony was acting, because she was acting like maybe she twisted her ankle.
Yeah. Harmony's like, tough.
She was talking normal, like wasn't even acting like anything hurt. And I'm thinking, isn't a compound fracture like when the bone comes out your skin?
I don't know.
Because I would think she'd be like screaming and stuff.
Yeah. There may be reasons. There may be reasons why they cut that out, because they looked it up and they're like, we can't do that.
maybe. But yes. Okay. So, and they talk about how it probably wasn't a ghost because it bumped into Buffy.
Mm-hmm.
And they decided they think it is an invisible person. And I feel like they got to invisible person really fast.
Yeah. I mean.
Because I would have thought that.
If it's not a ghost, but Buffy like felt it like bump into her and didn't see anything, then I think that would be the next logical place to go. I don't feel like it's as insane of a leap as some of the other leaps that we've talked about. But yeah.
Like praying mantis woman. Yeah. That was a pretty big leap too.
Also, just gotta throw it out there, but at the beginning of this scene, we see some men in suits that are just hanging out in the schoolyard.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that part. Yeah.
Which, I'm sorry, but is it their whole job to be covert? It's like they learned the same strategies that Buffy did as far as being subtle.
Wait, don't we see them at the, when Cordelia's doing her speech?
Yeah, that's later in the episode, though. And Willow, I think, even points them out at that point. Willow's just like, what are they doing? Like, they are so obvious.
They are seen before then. See, I don't remember seeing them.
Yeah, they're in the schoolyard at the beginning of this scene.
I do not.
So it's just a quick shot of them, and then it cuts to the gang.
I'm going to have to watch again and see if I see them. Yeah. And they talk about it, and they decide that the invisible girl has one thing in common, like all her victims, and it's Cordelia.
Mm-hmm.
And as they're leaving, we have the other cute little scene between Xander and Willow when they talk about going to dinner to eat at Xander's house.
Oh, yeah. Those few lines of dialogue do so much for both of those characters. It develops that relationship a little bit. It develops a little bit more understanding about Xander's home life, which, again, we get sprinkled
history
throughout. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I really like it. But I'm sorry, the geek in me cannot let this rest, but when Xander mentions the idea of Greek gods using cloaks of invisibility, and then Buffy comes back with that this girl is a little petty for a god, I'm just like,
they're kind of petty.
Did you not understand anything about Greek gods at all?
Yeah.
I'm just like, and I know, like, most of the, like, writing staff for Buffy eventually, I don't know at this point, but most of the writing staff for Buffy are nerdy enough to know that this is not a good line of dialogue. Yet somehow it made to the final cut. And I'm just like, I'm so disappointed. That's it. That's what my soul feels better now for pointing that out. We can move on. So Buffy and Giles have a little conversation, and Buffy says that she's going to kind of hunt and patrol around the school that night. And Giles makes the lovely comment that Buffy might actually have to start listening to people if she's going to hunt someone who's invisible. Which is a lovely transition into the next scene where Buffy is in the hall, kind of just making the rounds. But while she's there, kind of observing Cordelia through the window, we get this really nice moment that I think really works of Buffy, like, reflecting on her history and where she came from and where she is now. And it's a really nice, like, dialogue-free moment that says a lot about Buffy and the sacrifices that she's made and how I feel like even though we think that, and I think even Buffy thinks that she's better off now than how she was before, there's still a part of her that really misses that. Yeah.
Yeah.
And there was a touch on that earlier in the episode, too, that I think we passed where Xander says, you know, who would want to be May Queen? And Buffy's like, well, I was at my old school, basically that same person I was, you know.
It's kind of the whole part of her. She doesn't really, she still feels like an odd man out here in Sunnydale. But, and then she hears flute music and starts following it to the band room. And we cut back to the library and something really, really exciting happens. Where Angel and Giles meet for the very first time.
This scene blew my mind a little bit. Because I did not remember Giles being quite this giddy around Angel. Because they are definitely not, like, super friendly later on in the series.
Well, until, like, midway season two, they are friendly.
Yeah.
They work together and everything.
But
and like, it's all because of this moment, this conversation.
But, oh man, this shocked me quite a bit. Because I'll be honest, I'm a huge Buffy fan. I love rewatching Buffy. But, like, I usually watch a couple select episodes and then I start, like, partway through season two and then watch from there. Yeah. There's a lot of skippable episodes up until that point.
Season one.
Season one, quite a few in the first half of season two. So, for me, like, rewatching these episodes and remembering these things, I'm just like, holy crap, like, Giles kind of liked Angel at one point.
Oh yeah, they worked together well until things happened. And I think it's all because of this one conversation where there's a book that was lost years ago and Angel can get it for him.
Mm-hmm.
And it has Slayer prophecies. And like, you know, he's the Watcher. Of course he wants that.
Oh, yeah.
Like, wow, something the Watchers Council can't get, you know. And he starts thinking of Angel as an ally and a friend almost immediately. And then, you know, later in the episode when Angel saves their lives, there's no reason not to trust him at this point.
Mm-hmm. Giles is me. Like, the way to Giles's heart is through books.
Books are pretty awesome.
Angel's like, hey, I can get you a book. And Giles is like, sold. You're my favorite.
Yeah. Hey, you know, he never liked Spike. Spike never got him a book.
No. Spike was a TV guy, not for Giles.
But, yeah, they talk about the invisible girl a little bit. And you can see their relationship kind of start to develop a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Before we move on from this scene, because I made such a big deal about it when Giles called the Master the Vampire King earlier in the season. But he calls the Master the Vampire King again in this episode. So clearly it was a decision to make him the Vampire King. But only Giles, I think, refers to him as such. And I don't know if that's just something that, like, he picked up on from one random, you know, history book about the Master or something and just latched onto. But Giles is really stuck to that label. So good on him.
Okay, the next scene is another flashback. We're in the girls' bathroom and we finally see our invisible girl in the mirror.
Mm-hmm.
And she's, the description of her in the script book says she's so mousy that she's a human equivalent of wallpaper.
These are some weird descriptions.
Yes. I mean, I think she's actually kind of cute. I mean, she doesn't look that mousy to me. But we've got Cordelia and her gang, and they're talking. And Marcy, the invisible girl,
makes a comment like 3 or 4 times and they completely ignore her. And then Cordelia makes the same comment and everyone laughs. And so she was just like, she wasn't even there.
Yeah, I think that scene played really well. It might have been a little heavy-handed, but it's, you know, to be expected, especially from season one. But really, a lot of Buffy is pretty heavy-handed. But it conveys that feeling really well. And I think that the actress did a good job of just kind of faking along with the, oh, at least I'm kind of around them and I'm going to smile and like pretend like I'm part of this group, even though I know I'm not at all.
Trying to make herself be part of it.
Yeah. But yeah, that when Cordy says that, like repeats the line about the toupee and the actress like kind of laughs along, I think that that's a really nice layered performance by her, because she somehow, with a very smiling face reacting to the joke, conveys in that moment how much hurt she's feeling.
And then the next scene is Principal Snyder announcing the winner of May Queen, and it is, surprise, surprise, Cordelia. And she gives a speech.
Thank you for making the right choice and for showing me how much you all love me. Being this popular is not just my right, but my responsibility. And I want you to know I take it very seriously.
Which I'm wondering, this seems like a lot of effort for like sophomores. And I'm wondering if they do this for every grade. Because this seems like something that would happen your senior year. But I mean, they're sophomores, so I'm guessing they do it for each grade or each class or something. I don't know.
I just am having a vision of like, this is like the first time this has ever happened. And it's simply because the Chase has paid so much money to the school to be like, no, Cordelia wants to have a crown and she doesn't want to have to wait another year or two.
Yeah. And we have Buffy, Xander, and Willow talking about who it might be and the missing girls and all that. And this is the first time I saw the two men in black.
Mm-hmm.
Which, yeah, that phrase just doesn't work anymore, does it?
No.
No.
But
the two like government agency men standing there, I guess.
Yeah, this is the...
And Willow notices them too, because she says, did Cordelia hire bodyguards or something?
Yeah.
In their conversation, Willow gives Buffy a list of the missing students. And Buffy looks at it and she says, look at this. The most recent one, Marcy Ross, disappeared almost 6 months ago.
Yeah.
And I'm like, whoa, wait a second.
That doesn't make any sense.
That doesn't make any sense, because this is Sunnydale. And you know that there are students that have disappeared more recently than 6 months ago.
I wrote the exact same thing in my notes. I was just like, nope. I refuse to believe that that's the most recent.
I mean, I guess you could say that it's just been Desdis, but you know the vampires are making other vampires.
Mm-hmm.
Because in the very next episode, we have the Master with a whole bunch of vampires.
Yeah.
There's got to be more recently than 6 months. Yeah. And Buffy, or Xander and Willow, both say they don't know her. And they figure out it's her because she played the flute in the band and Buffy heard flute music. So now they know who our invisible girl is. And then the next scene, Buffy goes into the band room and kind of climbs up into the ceiling to look for our invisible girl. And I want to point out all the trophies in the band room, because there's like an entire wall of band trophies. There's just so many.
Yeah.
It seemed kind of excessive to me.
Maybe... Maybe Sunnydale just has an amazing band program, similar to its amazing cheerleading program that we saw in Witch.
I'm not sure how, when the students are always dying, but in some ways, Buffy is made to be such a giant, like Sunnydale is made to be such a giant school, when it's really supposed to be kind of a small town school. Like,
yeah,
they have like swim team that's state champions and stuff like that. And you're like, really now? Really?
Yeah. Xander even comments in this episode, like, yeah, I should know her, because like, it's, you know, yeah, sure, we're in a big school. Blah, 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 blah. I should know who Marcy is. Like, they even comment in this episode that Sunnydale High is not a big school, but apparently the band program's thriving. I don't know. I didn't.
Yes, so many trophies.
I didn't know notice the trophies, but it doesn't surprise me at all that they like overdecorated for that.
Well, and then it shows Buffy finding like a nest.
Mm-hmm.
There's blankets and a stuffed animal and a flute and other stuff up here, and you can tell someone's been living there.
Yeah.
And obviously it's our invisible girl. And then we see she finds a yearbook and starts looking through it and figures out that it is Marcy's yearbook and that's who she is. And meanwhile, we see a knife floating in the air behind her. And I have a theory about this scene.
Okay, I'm ready.
Okay, so the knife is behind her, and, you know, obviously it's Marcy ready to, you know, attack her like she's done everyone else, and because she didn't want to be discovered. But you see the knife there, and right as Buffy says, Marcy Ross, so it is you, the knife kind of falls down, like puts down. And I honestly think that Marcy was acknowledged, mm-hmm. like who she was acknowledged that she existed. And so she didn't kill Buffy or attack Buffy. I don't think she would have succeeded because it's Buffy. But she didn't attack Buffy because Buffy acknowledged who she was.
Mm-hmm.
That's my theory anyway.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because the knife goes down before Buffy starts to leave.
Yeah. I like that. The truth about Marcy is that she also never really seems to have the intent to kill. You could say that maybe with Miss Miller, it could have gone to...
Yeah, except for Miss Miller.
It could have gone to kill, but it wasn't successful, and I don't know if that was intentional to not be successful or if she did intend to kill Miss Miller, but everything else seems to be, like, just to the point of...
Pain
and suffering. I do like the acknowledging thing. I think that that's my chosen way of reading it. I think another alternative is... we learn that since she's been kind of just observing everybody in the school for such time and kind of knows everybody's secrets, that she does know that Buffy is capable. Like, she knows, she says, makes a comment at the end of the episode, like, what are you going to do, slay me? So she knows that Buffy's the Slayer. She probably doesn't fully understand what that means, but she knows that Buffy would outmatch her most likely. But I think that you're right in that that's what causes her to hesitate. And then ultimately, I think that the fact that Buffy starts to move and then she kind of panics and just backs off completely. But I think that that's the moment of hesitation, is like, that is probably in the context of this show and what we understand what happened to this girl, the first time that she's heard her name said out loud by a person in a very, very long time. So, yeah.
Even before she went invisible.
Yeah. I think that that's what caused that hesitation, when that knife was there, ready to strike, and then she heard her name.
Well, Buffy leaves, and she takes the yearbook with her, and then we cut to the teacher, Miss Miller, sitting at her desk, and she's waiting for Cordelia. A plastic bag whips down over her head, and she starts suffocating,
mm-hmm.
which is why I think that Marcy might not have been trying to kill them, but she obviously didn't care if they died. Because, like, Harmony getting pushed down the stairs, she just got hurt a little bit. But I'm thinking she could have been killed.
Yeah.
Those are some very tall stairs.
Yeah.
It could have killed her. So she might not be trying, but she doesn't care if it happened.
Yeah, I think that that's, like, fair. I think that... I don't know. Her entire process is hard to understand, and I think that that's part of why they kind of go with this idea that she's had some mental breakdown and doesn't really know what she's doing anymore. It seems like the steps along the way to get to the final showdown where she's gonna carve up Cordelia's face. I don't know, like, Harmony kind of makes the most sense, because Harmony, I think, was more directly also mean to Marcy. I don't really know. Maybe the teacher, because the teacher never called on her on that one flashback. I don't think we see any experience with Mitch. It just seems like what happens, I think, in this show a lot, and potentially in real life, though, I don't have enough experience or knowledge in this area to know, but like, it seems like a lot of people tend to, in this show, put all of their problems on one individual.
Yes.
And it's usually Buffy. Like, usually, like, it's the bad guy, and like, I would have gotten away with it, too, if it wasn't for that meddling Buffy. But here it's Cordelia. Cordelia is the one that is all of Marcy's problems embodied in one single person.
Yeah. When it's kind of the fault of everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Including her non-existent family.
Yeah, her family apparently doesn't exist. But even, like, people that we acknowledge, like, and here's the crazy thing is that in a weird way, Cordy was the one that interacted with Marcy the most. It was always mean, but she at least...
But it was interaction.
Yeah, she at least interacted with the girl.
But Cordelia comes in here to Miss Miller and finds her with the plastic bag over her face and rips it off. And Miss Miller says she didn't see who attacked her. And then they see chalk writing on the board all by itself.
Mm-hmm.
And it writes the word listen. So now we have look and listen.
Which, I'll have to note, that's actually a pretty decent effect for Buffy season one. Like, that was a pretty good, like, invisible, like, hand writing on the board.
Mm-hmm.
I was impressed. It doesn't take much for season one to impress me on special effects. But that did it.
Yeah. And then we're back to the trio and Giles talking. And they're in the library and Buffy tells them what she found and shows them the yearbook, and they have a discussion about how everyone wrote Have a Nice Summer in it.
Mm-hmm. Also, a point to note, that yearbook's thick. And I don't know if it's just because of the in-memory section or what it is, but that is a thick yearbook.
Yeah, that is a giant yearbook. Like, yeah. And the school's not supposed to be that big. And it's in this conversation that Xander makes the comment, well, we probably didn't see her except to sign her yearbook. This is a big school.
Mm-hmm.
And they decide kind of that Marcy turned invisible because no one noticed her.
Yes.
She was just overlooked by everyone in her life. And at this point, we wonder, did she have parents? Did she have siblings? Like, how do you ignore your child that much? Because, I mean, I'm assuming she didn't live at school before she became invisible.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it could have done a lot of background into her family and stuff for this. But we just get to see her school life.
Mm-hmm. And that's the thing where it kind of breaks down, because one would presume the way that that Giles explains it is that, you know, the way that this person became invisible is because everybody perceived her as such.
It's a rudimentary concept that reality is shaped, even created by our perception.
And with the Hellmouth below us sending out mystical energy,
people perceived Marcy as invisible, and she became so.
Which would have to include her parents, right? Like, if literally, if what it takes to become invisible is to not be seen by anybody, that would, you would assume, include her family. Yet again, you have this circumstance where she's placed all of this anger and aggression on Cordelia specifically, and I'm just like, her parents had to have messed her up if they didn't even acknowledge her existence. So it's kind of one of those things, you just kind of have to embrace the idea that nobody in the Buffyverse has, like, a family.
Yeah.
Because that happens on occasion, where you have all of these students and all of these other people that we interact with, and they just don't have families, and we don't talk about that. But I love the idea of this. I love the idea that the Hellmouth is so powerful and sending out all of this energy and can kind of shape reality based on how everybody perceives it. I think it's a really, like, cool idea. Obviously, it falls apart in a ton of different ways when you think about, like, other things going on in the series. But I like this. I think it's a cool, like, science fiction story of this idea of nobody paid attention to this person to the point where reality decided that this person could not be seen.
And I like the idea of the Hellmouth having a lot to do with that, too. Although, there's a comment at the end of this episode where the men in black are taking Marcy away, and Buffy comments how this isn't the first time. This has happened before in other schools, right? And they say no comment.
Mm-hmm.
So it get just be the, unless it was Cleveland. there is a comment in this scene from Xander, which before Cordelia comes in, which I thought that you might be interested in. You're not going to like it, but given your issues with Xander, I thought you might be interested.
Okay.
Xander makes a comment about is kind of curiosity as to whether or not people perceived Marcy as invisible with her clothes or if she's naked all the time.
What?
Yeah, it got cut out, obviously. But, like, is she just wandering around naked all the time, or did they perceive her clothes as invisible, too?
Yeah, yeah.
But when I was reading the script book before this, I was like, oh, I can imagine what Megan would do with that comment.
What the crazy thing is like, that never even occurred to me, but it is kind of a valid thing, like, could she not just put on, like, clothes, or is it like automatically in contact with her? Like when she picks up items, you can see the items float.
Well, and at the end when Buffy throws like when she gets tangled in that cloth,
yeah,
during the final fight, you can see her.
So like I'm not mad at Xander so much as like legitimately wondering myself, is she naked all the time, or is she just wearing the same clothes that she initially turned invisible in and never changes?
It's a good question. Although I probably wasn't clear that the Xander does this in kind of a teenage boy naked girl way.
Oh yeah, I completely know what the reading would be.
Yeah,
you gotta just pass over some of that stuff with Xander. I mean, there's a yeah. line earlier of Xander that's kind of ick that we just kind of passed over because there's just so much of that. Like, I completely understand where the reading would have come from, but now I'm just like curious about the like logistics of it. Now that that's been like. Clearly, she either has to be in the clothes that she originally turned invisible in, or she's mm-hmm. got to be naked. Those are the two yeah. options.
Well, and then we have Cordelia busts in.
Buffy, I know we've had our differences with you being so weird and all, and hanging out with these total losers. Ooh. Well, anyway, despite all of that, I know that you share this feeling that we have for each other deep down.
Nausea?
Somebody is after me. They just tried to kill Mrs. Miller. She was helping me with my homework. And Mitch and Harmony. This is all about me. Me, me, me.
Which I'll have to say it's very observant of Cordelia to go to Buffy.
Yeah.
To realize Buffy can help her.
Mm-hmm.
Like she's been paying more attention than you think.
Yeah. And here's what I'll say. Cordelia's super uneven in this episode for me. I think some of the dialogue that she has in this scene in particular really kind of bothers me. Later on, she has that line of just like, oh, you know, when Giles is saying, oh, I've never seen you in here before. And she's like, no, I have a life. And I'm just like, but there's been several times where she's shown to be more of an academic.
In the library. Yeah.
Like she guides Buffy there in the very first episode. She's much mm-hmm. more prepared for the history test and seems to be nailing it, even though it's like a nightmare dreamscape, whatever. You know, yeah. I think that that's more who Cordelia is. Cordelia is supposed to be smart and actually know her stuff. And she just seems like really not quite Cordelia in a lot of this scene where it's like no. they haven't quite gotten her to that like some
part yet.
Some writers know it and some writers don't kind of deal. Like some writers mm-hmm. understand who Cordelia is supposed to be and some writers don't. And we'll get into that more and yeah. more with other characters. Like I think there's a huge disparity yeah. in writing quality for Anya when it comes to stuff like that. Because I think some yeah. writers write Anya fantastic and some writers just don't need to write Anya ever. But I like, mm-hmm. I really noticed it with Cordelia here. It's just like, she doesn't really feel like Cordelia in certain scenes in this episode. Other scenes I like her in this episode, but sometimes I'm just like, ooh, Cordelia, what happened?
Yeah, it was like there was two different writers on Cordelia in here, in this yeah. one.
Well, it's story by Joss Whedon, and then there were two writers credited yeah. for the teleplay, so there's technically three voices intermixed here, so who knows.
But can we talk about in this scene how when they tell Cordelia that there is an invisible girl after her, she just accepts it?
Yeah.
Like, okay, what are we going to do about it? Like, this is a Like, I think I would have questions. Like, how do you know there's an invisible girl? She's just like, okay, what do we do about it? Like, last week, you know, invisible bird was after her or something. You know, it's like, this is normal to her.
Yeah. So when Buffy is explaining that it's an invisible girl, Cordy makes the comment, I don't care what it is. And Buffy's just like, well, the thing is, it's a person. And it makes it more complicated. So we got another kind of idea of when it's actually a human, it becomes a more difficult thing to face and deal with. Again, the way that they decide to wrap it up at the end of this episode is really weird and bizarre, but they have to figure out how to deal with humans in this episode. If they keep wanting to deal with humans as the enemy in this series, they have to figure out ways to beat them without Buffy slaying them at the end of the episode. I think it was interesting that even after Buffy starts to explain that it's a person, Cordy, like, no, it's a bad thing. It's got to go away. And Buffy has to kind of rationalize the thing. Because here's what happens in Buffy's arc in this episode is that she really wants to sympathize with Marcy. And then at the end of the episode, she really doesn't sympathize with Marcy at all. Again, one of those signs of early Buffy being super empathetic and understanding and, like, trying to, like, really get to the heart of what's going on. And I kind of wish that they had done a little bit more with that instead of just made Marcy like a creepy assassin. But I think your read on it, you know, they can only do so much in a hour-long episode. I think that's why they did so much better when they went to more like season arc kind of stuff instead of a one-off episode thing.
You could explore things a lot more.
Yeah, they're so ambitious with some of these ideas, and I really like some of the directions that they're going in, and then it's just like, she's hired by the government to be a spy, and I'm just like, that is not the direction I thought that was going in. But I like this, like, moment of Buffy just, you know, trying to process, how do you deal with this? How do you deal with it when it's a person?
This isn't this great power that she can control. It's something that was done to her. We did to her.
It's something that Buffy's very conscious of. The way in which people can be victims and then, because they're victims, start hurting other people, and where that line may be. Because she's still very sympathetic, even though at this point, well, 2 to 3 people in various parts of the conversation, Buffy knows that Marcy's attacked. She's still very sympathetic to Marcy, and it's just interesting to look at that perspective, especially when we talk about this idea of Buffy kind of gradually losing some of that and becoming less and less patient later on. And I think we did also skip over the flashback where the students were very, very engaged in the lesson, and it didn't make any sense because they've never seen that many students raise their hands ever. But
oh yeah, it's an exciting discussion going on in the classroom.
But I think we've touched on that enough that we could probably
yeah.
So they make the call to use Cordelia as bait, which Cordelia's not super jazzed about, but she still gets to go to the coronation, which is good. We get a scene between Cordelia and Buffy out in the hall, and this is kind of the, like, real Cordelia moment, right? Where she talks a little bit about the isolation of being popular. It's an interesting perspective, because I think the message, and I think, what is it? Is it Earshot? I think Earshot does it better, whereas, like, everybody's hurting, and that's why nobody cares that you're hurting kind of idea. But I think Cordelia kind of gives that lesson here a little bit, you know, is that idea of just because Marcy's kind of shaped Cordelia to have this perfect life doesn't mean that Cordelia is actually happy. I don't know. I really like the line, it beats being alone all by yourself. I think that's a very...
Yeah, that's a very empathetic, like, makes you feel very empathetic toward Cordelia. And
yeah.
She is not a character that usually creates that feeling.
Yeah.
Although I will say, I mean, if Cordelia was a little bit more sincere with people and like kinder to people, she probably would have friends who did listen to her.
Mm-hmm.
Because we see that a little in season 2 and 3 when she becomes part of the Scooby Gang.
Yeah, I think that's what they're foreshadowing to in this, is that this is going to be an eventual friendship. Like I said, I wish I would have done more with Cordelia and Buffy, because I think that as much as I enjoy Cordelia and Xander, having Xander really being the only entry point for Cordelia to become part of the Scoobies, even though it was already kind of developed to be Buffy, like Buffy was supposed to be her entry point, but it kind of shifts a little bit and becomes more focused on Xander and less on Buffy. I wish that they would have developed Buffy and Cordy just a little bit more than they did. Because I like scenes like this. I think this scene and the scene coming up in a little bit are both really good Cordelia and Buffy scenes. Which, I mean, we'll get to the next scene pretty much right away, because really the only thing that we have in between now and then is Xander, Willow, and Giles being like, oh, there's a flute. Let's go and follow it. Because that seems like a good idea.
Yeah, instead of going to get Buffy to follow it. They follow it and kind of like attempt to talk to Marcy, and they end up in the boiler room for some reason, because that would be somewhere I would never ever go in the school. And they discover a audio cassette player. It actually says audio cassette player in the script book, which I made sure to write in my notes. They realize it is playing for loop music, and the door shuts and bolts behind them.
Yep, which means
they are stuck.
Yeah, and it's in a basement. The boiler room. It's in a basement. They're locked in a basement. They're trapped in a basement. It's a counter.
Oh, yes, it is a counter. I was totally thinking, she's trying to say it's a counter, but they're not dead in a basement. But yes, they are locked in a basement, so that makes two. And then they hear a hiss, and oh, someone has turned on the gas.
Mm-hmm. So now we're back to Buffy and Cordelia again, and this is Buffy trying to do the heart-to-heart, and Cordelia keeps interrupting in just lovely ways. A couple of the readings I don't really like. I don't really like the fact that Cordelia surprised that Buffy was popular, because Cordelia should know that based on the way that she reacted to Buffy in the first episode. Like, immediately was just like, oh yeah, you're cool. You passed the quiz. So she should know that.
Yeah. And then we hear like a thump, and Buffy breaks down the door, and Cordelia is being pulled into the ceiling.
Mm-hmm. Which, this is my first time of noting, Marcy is too strong. And there's a couple of examples that I'm going to use in this latter part of the episode. But Marcy is too strong.
It's possible that when she went invisible, she started working out.
Yeah.
You know, in the gym at night when no one's in the school. She has full access.
Yeah, I mean, sure, I'll give it to her. We can't see her. We don't know how swole she is. She could be like all the muscles.
True.
But yeah, that, like, I saw that, like, the just like almost comical, like, just Cordelia being flipped into the ceiling. I'm just like, huh.
She is very strong for a random teenage girl. And Buffy follows her, and then we are back to the boiler room, and they figured out that the hissing is gas. The gas is full up, and there's no pilot light, and Xander grabs a pipe and starts to hit the door to try to break it down, and Giles is smart enough to stop him so that there's no sparks, which would, you know, blow up the whole school, which actually happens later seasons. Which does not happen tonight or during this episode. We're back to Buffy. Buffy is kind of fighting with Marcy a little bit and falls through the ceiling of the band room. And all of a sudden, a hypodermic needle is plunged into her neck, which I'm curious how Marcy knew how to do that. I can imagine where she got the supplies and stuff, because she's invisible. So she could probably sneak into anywhere in town she wants and steal whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So she probably snuck into, like, the hospital and stole drugs and stuff. But how does she know how to administer that properly?
She's really good. Like, I could see why the FBI wants her. Like, she's really good. But, oddly enough, not my biggest question mark of this. My question mark is, after she knocks out Buffy, then again, proving that she's somehow very strong, because she somehow gets both Buffy and Cordelia from the school to the bronze, tied up in, like, the coronation thrones.
Yeah,
which obviously she probably drove part of that way, but she still got him all the way to his car and then drove all the way and then unloaded them and drug them up to the stage. It was very intricate.
That is a very good question. And it did not occur to me to think about it until just now, how she got them to the bronze, because, you know, they're not invisible. And also, the bronze seems to be open every night of the week, except this night.
Well, it's closed for the coronation,
which is not till the next day.
Is it not till the next? I thought it was that night, because I thought Cordelia was getting dressed for the coronation in the closet.
Well, what time is it? Like, it's 11 in the, p.m.?
It's in the middle of the day still. Like, because when the government boys come in, it's broad daylight outside. So it's still the middle of the day.
Oh, see, that makes it even more curious how she got them to the bronze. Yeah.
Like, it doesn't make, like, somebody.
Because I was thinking it was night.
Yeah. Somebody should have seen, like, these unconscious people just floating, getting moved around.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so. Wow. Well, so then the next scene, they wake up in the bronze, and Cordelia and Buffy are both tied into chairs, and Cordelia is wearing her May Queen crown.
Mm-hmm.
And is very terrified because her face is numb.
Yeah, that's not a good thing.
No, that's actually pretty scary. And then we're back to the boiler room where they're kind of passing out from the gas.
Yeah, I love there's a moment, and I love that they had this moment where Giles, like, gouges his hand really bad just to try to slow down the gas. I just think it's a nice little subtle moment to show
that he's a hero.
He's a hero.
Yeah, he's always a hero. Not always the hero, always a hero. Sense?
Got it.
He rarely saves the day, but he's always willing to, you know, do whatever it takes. I like the imagery where they're all three kind of passed out and leaning against the door, and Giles is just kind of, as much as he can, banging against the door with his hand.
Yeah. And what I'll say, you know, just for the sake, because it's, again, another one of those back and forths, let's go ahead and finish the basement stuff. Okay. And then we'll cut back to Marcy and the gang.
The back and forths at the end of every episode make them very exciting to watch, but there makes it a lot harder to discuss scene by scene.
Yeah.
So they're passed out against the door, and all of a sudden it opens, and it's Angel come to save the day.
Which is how I first noticed the daylight thing earlier, because I was just like, how did Angel get there? I was like, he probably came in through the sewer system. That's why he's in the basement. So that rationalized all of that. It doesn't make the Marcy thing any better, but I was just like, that was the first thing. I was just like, how did Angel get to the school if it's broad daylight? But then I realized that the sewers are a thing. But yeah, Angel shows up. He gets Giles up, and then Giles takes Xander out. And then there's this little moment where he, like, checks Willow's pulse before he picks Willow up to make sure that she's alive. And I don't really even know why they have that moment. Like, I want to read more into it than's actually there. But it was just, like, a weird choice to make him take that pause to, like, check her pulse before he picks her up.
Probably trying to show how he cares.
Maybe. I don't, like, it was like, I was really trying to, like, read into it. Like, is it trying to show that she was that far gone that he couldn't just, because, I mean, the idea is, like, vampires are keenly aware of heartbeats and blood rushing and stuff like that. So maybe he was just like, oh my God, Willow may be dead right here. She perks up pretty fast when she's outside. So I don't think.
Yeah, they all do.
The asphyxiation was quite as bad as it could have been. They probably recovered a little too fast. realistically, considering how long they've been breathing that stuff in.
And Angel goes back in to turn the gas off because, you know, he says, I don't need the oxygen.
Yeah.
Which is kind of a thing in the whole Buffyverse. It goes back and forth with different episodes and stuff. But sometimes vampires breathe and sometimes they don't.
Oh, I am going to comment so much on the next episode about that issue, but we aren't there yet, so.
Yeah.
You have one little moment here where Xander realizes it was Angel who saved him and immediately says, "What do you want?"
Yeah.
I'm just like, Xander, stop.
And like, nobody thanks him. Because Buffy was not going to make it back to get them.
All right.
Okay, so while all that is happening, we've got Cordelia and Buffy and Marcy at the Braun. And Marcy starts talking and she's very threatening and she's trying to explain about why she's so angry and what she's going to do and all that. And the curtain, we forgot to mention that the curtain across from Cordelia and Buffy says learn.
Yeah.
So now we have look, listen, and learn.
And all of her, like, dialogue in this bit is just, it's really good stuff.
You should be grateful. I mean, people who pass you on the street are going to remember you for the rest of their lives. Children are going to dream about you. And every one of your friends who comes to the coronation tonight will take the sight of the May Queen to their graves.
That dialogue.
Yeah.
I'm just like, ooh.
Yeah. And there's a point where Buffy says, "Marcy, you can't do this." And Marcy replies, "What are you going to do? Slay me."
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, whoa. Like, how long have you been floating around the school listening to private conversations?
Yeah.
Like, can you imagine everything that this girl knows? Because she obviously knows the Slayer exists.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, supernatural things and vampires and stuff exist. Like, she might have actually been there the night that Darla broke into the school with the guy and turned him into a vampire, you know?
Yeah.
She might have been watching that, which just, it's an amazing line because you're just like, oh.
Yeah.
How long has she been watching them?
Yeah. And we have, I think it may be Cordelia who even says earlier in the episode, like, imagine, like, she knows all of our deepest, darkest secrets. She's just been around listening to us.
Oh, I didn't get, I don't remember catching that part.
But. Yeah. It's not like, I mean, it's a very creepy thing to think about. I like this episode thematically a lot of what it's trying to do. It's in a weird way similar to, like, the speech that Xander gives to Dawn in season 7, right? Of this idea of when you're not seen, you see everything. And that's very much what's happening here with Marcy, is she's so invisible that all she can do is observe. There's some really, like, cool stuff and cool places that they took it and could have taken it even further. But then they get to this moment of just kind of cutting it off with this quick rationalization from Buffy, where she's just like, "I felt sorry for you, but turns out you're a thundering loony." And that's where this episode loses me completely. Everything that happens with Marcy after that, I'm just like, I don't like this. I'm not a fan of the conclusion of Marcy's story. I think the build-up, the setup, everything that they, like, the themes of it is all really cool. And then once you get that to that line, I'm just like, that's where I check out as far as how they decided to conclude
it. Well, can you imagine the mental illness and disconnect from yourself and everything you would have to feel to turn invisible?
Oh, yeah.
And then dealing with that after.
Yeah, like, she's lived like this for
six months.
And it's such a weird thing to go from witch, where Buffy is so sympathetic to this idea of Amy's doing all of these terrible things because her mother caused her to do that, to this where Buffy's not sympathetic with Marcy at all at the end of this episode, even though in this same episode she was like, "We did this to her."
Well, she was sympathetic until Marcy started trying to carve up Cordelia's face.
Yeah, but in which there is a line that Buffy says while she's dying, where she says, "Amy only became a witch to try to
please her mother."
Please her mother.
True.
It seems this line doesn't feel like some of the other stuff
Buffy has done
in this season. Like in I, Robot, You, Jane, when Xander's like, "I'm gonna kill..." Oh, what's his face? I can't think of his name. After Buffy gets electrocuted, and she's just like, "He tried to warn me." Like, there's several instances where Buffy gets attacked, just straight on attacked, and still
has sympathy,
sympathizes with these people. And here she's just like, "Nope, no more patience with this girl." And it seems weird considering they've had several instances in this episode where she really tries to have patience with her, and then it's like a light switch, and I don't like it.
Yeah, I can see that. But during this whole scene, while they've been talking, Buffy's trying to get loose from her bonds, and she does that. She gets loose and immediately starts trying to get Cordelia loose. And while she's doing that, Marcy punches her.
Mm-hmm.
And punches strong enough to knock the Slayer backwards.
Oh,
so,
yeah.
Very strong.
Marcy's been working out a lot.
So they fight for a little bit, and then Buffy knocks Marcy into the curtain, which covers her, and oh, now we can see her.
Yeah.
Which does lead credence to the thing that Marcy is wandering around naked.
It's very possible. But yeah, this is when the FBI shows up.
We can rehabilitate her.
In time, she'll learn to be a useful member of society again.
Where are we going? Very useful.
This isn't the first time this has happened, is it? It's happened at other schools.
We're not at liberty to discuss that.
It would be best for you to forget this whole incident.
Do you know that you guys are very creepy?
Thank you for your help.
Oh, and have a nice day.
No subtlety at all, because up at this point, like, just casually hanging around this school, Willow notices them, like, they're not... But then they...
Hiding.
They're not hiding. But then they get to this moment and practically just tell Buffy, she's like, yeah, we're taking her so she can be a spy for us.
Yeah. And it's this one I have in my notes. I'm like, they are way cavalier about this. Why would they not, you know, be trying to make sure that these teenage girls don't talk about what they've just seen? Because if this happened in other cities and other towns, those kids would talk. Because they're not on a hellmouth where they forget about everything. You know, they would be like, hey, so I was attacked by this invisible girl and then the government came and took her.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just like, although this is our first glimpse of that the government as a whole knows about supernatural stuff.
Yeah.
Like knows it exists and is trying to use it for their benefit.
Yeah.
Because the ending scene is Marcy being escorted into a classroom with a whole lot of invisible students and opening her book with that is about assassination and infiltration.
Yeah. Like, there's...
So she has been trying to be, like, work for the government.
Oh, yeah. There's so many questions I have about all of that.
Oh, yes. Yes. Very, many, many questions.
Very briefly, before we get to that scene, there is, like, a concluding scene with Buffy where she asks how they got out of the basement and they lie about it being Angel. And that's something that we haven't really talked about. This is the first time that Angel has appeared since the episode Angel, when they did mm-hmm. actually say we can't be around each other. And it's mentioned several times. Like, it's a through line in this episode where Angel's like, I can't be around Buffy. It's too hard. And mm-hmm. and Giles and Willow and Xander are kind of covering up, you know.
Yeah, they say it's the janitor.
Yeah. And I like that they have that through line. I'm interested to see going forward, because I can't really remember how the Angel-Buffy relationship develops in the beginning parts of season 2, because I think, like, some of the episodes that have some of the best development for them is also episodes that I tend to skip on rewatches a lot. But I liked going from the ending of Angel to the couple of moments that we had with Angel in this scene. I think that that's a very natural progression for those characters and made a lot of sense. And I just totally spaced on it in the Giles scene earlier because I was just like, Giles really likes Angel. This is confusing. But for some reason, when I was looking at my notes on this part, I was like, oh, yeah, Angel and Buffy have not interacted at all.
And then we have the scene where Cordelia thanks them.
Oh, man.
For helping her.
Good on Cordy. And the fact that it's Willow that invites Cordelia, I think, is also telling. But yeah.
But then Mitch walks up. And you're not hanging with these losers, are you? You know? And then Cordelia reverts right back to herself.
Yeah. I wrote Mitch pulls Cordy back to the dark side.
Yes, definitely.
But yeah, the Marcy final conclusion thing. Okay, first off, here's the first thing to note. Those books that are on those tables are worn to death. Like, they are worn out. And it's just,
and
like...
very old.
How many classes has those books been through? Like, how many invisible people does the FBI have? Like, I need to know this. It's quite terrifying.
And was that meant? Like, did they mean to make it look like that? Like, there's been thousands?
I don't know, but it is scary to think of. There are parts of this that kind of work as, like, a... Yeah, that would be the logical thing that this person would be pulled into, right, is something like that, to be in a super spy. This person is definitely qualified to be a super spy, and apparently an assassin as well, which Marcy, I think, is capable of doing. Maybe not all invisible people, but Marcy specifically, I think, would be fine with assassination. But it's one of those things that just doesn't... It's kind of like the robots in the Buffyverse. Like, they're there, but they don't ever really feel like they're quite part of the universe. Ted, the Buffy bot, like, there's episodes where they're like, there's just robots. And I'm just like, but why? And I feel like this is a similar thing. I'm just like, but why?
My questions are much simpler than your questions. Mine are like, how do they keep these students from taking over the school? Or like, how do they know the students are actually there in the classroom and aren't playing hooky?
Mm-hmm.
You can't take attendance, really. I mean, I guess you could, but, you know, like, my questions are way simpler than yours are. How do you know when they're going to bed when they're supposed to go to bed, or in the cafeteria when they're supposed to be in the cafeteria and stuff like that? Like, how does this work?
Well, and is this implying
that all of
these... Why are
you not making them wear clothes?
But is this implying that these are all, like, high schoolers? Or, like, can this happen at any age?
Oh, good point. Like, are there toddler... Is there a toddler invisible school? That's just... No, I don't want to talk about that. That's just... Sad.
That's no.
Let's go with high schoolers and up.
High schoolers and up.
I know we want to think about how that would happen to a child.
Oh, so on a lighter note.
Yeah.
The
please do a lighter note.
The chapter that she opens up to, Assassination and Infiltration, Case Example 1, Radical Cult Leader as Intended Victim, and then is followed up by the lyrics to Happiness is a Warm Gun by the Beatles.
Okay, so I saw the cult leader part. I did not connect the song.
Well, and that's a bit of trivia I knew going into this episode, but I just remembered it was a Beatles song. I couldn't remember which one it was, but it's Happiness is a Warm Gun. You just know that's going on the playlist.
Yes, definitely. Well, that was Out of Sight, Out of Mind. Out of Mind, Out of Sight.
Yeah, I was wondering if you're going to catch it.
That was Out of Mind, Out of Sight. I do that every time.
That's what they get with those clever titles. What are they thinking?
Yeah, why are they trying to be complicated?
Goodness gracious, Kim. We're doing the season finale next week.
Season? We have made it through an entire season of Buffy.
I am excited. Yay. I'm so excited.
Prophecy Girl.
Woo! Yeah, we'll be back for that one and many more seasons to come. We're excited going into season 2. I know I am, at least. And
but 6 more seasons and then 5 of Angel.
Yeah.
Hopefully we get that far.
It's a daunting task, but I am surprised that we are already through season 1 practically, so
That is
exciting. But yeah, we'll be back next week with Prophecy Girl, like Kim said. And we thank you all so much for listening. And now we're going to go, like, bye and stuff.
Bye.
And stuff.